Welcome one, welcome all, to a new episode of Gorefest at Tiffany's here on the Outpost Unknown YouTube channel. We are the definitive show here on YouTube dedicated to our favorite Scream Queen, Tiffany Shepis. Now, my name is Matthew. Joining me once again on our ever-continuing journey through her never-ending filmography is Jeff.
Yeah, what's up? What's up? This is one of the better ideas we've ever had, I must say.
I think so. Yeah. I think so. We're still having fun. You know, we were worried on that first episode that we might be like, oh man, when you see how big and exhaustive the list is. But every episode, it's something completely different. We see new things. So I'm excited to keep going with this. But hey, there's going to be some new eyeballs on this, Jeff. Why should this new viewer who's just checking out this show and Outpost Unknown hit that like and subscribe button?
Well, we're doing interesting things, I feel like. If you're especially of your of an age like we are, and I'm not going to, you know, dox myself here and tell you exactly how old I am, but nostalgia is huge. And I'm feeling immense waves of nostalgia going back through these older Tiffany Shepis movies up through to today. And not only the movies, but also like this episode, we've got these music videos and crazy stuff like that that are it's a lot of fun. I'll just sit here and just watch nostalgia bait on YouTube all night long. And, you know, I want to get in on the action. And that's what maybe this show can do for you as well.
For sure. Hit that like and subscribe. We try to put these out once a month-ish. It's been a little while since our last one because we've been very, very busy with films. And we've had the Outpost Unknown crew fly down to Nebraska and hang out with us. We've been busy. But we're never too busy to watch a little Tiffany Shepis in our lives. Now, we have an absurdly jam-packed episode tonight. I mean, we have a lot of stuff to cover here, but I'm going to partially bury the lead here. If you are a Tiffany Shepis fan, as we are, we have something very, very special tonight that we're very excited to show. Now, if you've seen our previous episodes, we've stated our goal is to watch everything. We want to see everything Ms. Shepis has ever been in.
We're trying.
We are definitely trying. And to accomplish that, we have to do some sort of like Indiana Jones style searching, you know, if like for some films, we're like in the temple trying to get that golden idol. And folks, we have such a golden idol tonight. We are going to be debuting a few partial scenes from a never before seen lost Tiffany Shepis film that's over 20 years old. Now, I'm not going to say what it is yet, because, of course, we want those view hours, right? You have to stay to the end to watch it. But, Jeff, you have seen this footage. We escaped the temple as the poison darts were shooting at us. We have that idol. We're out. What are your initial thoughts on some of this unseen 20-plus-year-old Tiffany Shepis footage we've got here?
This is exciting. I mean, you're making jokes about like Indiana Jones and stuff, but frankly, it's exciting on that type of level. It's really fun to get a hold of something that you thought was lost. Lost media is something that I find endlessly intriguing, and here where it's specifically something in which we're, you know, directly interested in, it's just all the more.
Yeah, it's cool. I hope any Tiffany Shepis fan out there that's watching this will be very thrilled at the end of this episode when we sort of reveal what the lost film is and the scenes from it. Now, from what I understand, Ms. Shepis herself has never even seen this footage. So I'm hoping that she's cool with us sort of premiering it
that
here
rules.
And she's like, oh no, 20 plus year old footage from me from this lost movie. So hopefully she's cool with it. But yeah, stick around to the end of the episode. We are gonna sort of, I guess, kind of world premiere some never before seen Tiffany Shepis footage. I think it's like 4 or 5 minutes of it too. So it's not some quick clips, mind you. It's we got a couple partial scenes here that we're gonna show. Now, moving right along here, because again, jam-packed episode. Odds and ends. We have some odds and ends, and as we are sort of going through Ms. Shepis's filmography, you find things here and there throughout. You know, our first episode was all about trauma films, and so we're like, well, we got everything trauma related. Turns out we didn't. So I might start this new sort of segment here called Odds and Ends, and this will just be sort of like some catch-up things and things that Tiffany Shepis fans might be interested in seeing that we didn't you know, we missed on a particular episode. But before we sort of get into all of that, I do want to sort of plug Casualty Friday. So this is a weekly podcast that Tiffany does with Felissa Rose, of course, of Sleepaway Camp fame, and Kane Hodder, of course, of Friday the 13th fame. And I came across this neat little promo of them, of their show that was done a few years ago. This was on YouTube with them at the Beverly sort of promoting this, which you can watch right now.
Let's all go to the lobby. Let's all go to the lobby. Let's all go to the lobby to get ourselves a treat.
Holy shit, it is Casualty Friday, season 2. Right now we're live from the new Beverly Cinema in Hollywood.
We're having friends come over and I'm gonna probably kill somebody.
What I like about this podcast is they go so off the rails.
Yeah,
they never stick on topic. It's just constant weird stories, and they have interesting, fun topics like what is the weirdest convention experience you've ever had, and things of that nature, which it's just fun to hear them riff. Have you listened to any of them recently?
Yeah, it's very good, and they're good at it. When someone's good at talking like they are on Casualty Friday, then it doesn't really matter what they're talking about. And then also you add in that you are interested in what they're talking about, and it's just all the better. It's great.
For sure. And I think it's like an hour, each episode's like an hour long or something.
Yeah, they know what they're doing. It's good.
Yeah, good thing to pop on. We can cross the Casualty Friday promo off of our list of things, because that is a piece of media that Tiffany Shepis was in. So there you go. Check that out. Now, I came across this weird little clip from the Richard Bay Show. And this, if I had known about this before, of course, we would have put this in our episode 1 trauma stuff. Mm-hmm. But this is a fun clip I found of Tiffany and Debbie Rochon, another great scream queen that we love dearly, from 1996 on this thing called the Richard Bay Show, promoting Tromeo and Juliet. So I will go ahead and just play the clip here. It's a few minutes long, but we'll just show it in its entirety so everyone can check it out.
Welcome back to the Richie Show. You know, when I say names like Warner Brothers, Paramount, MGM. I mean, you get an image of your mind of the old Hollywood and the glamour and the mystique and the star system. But there is a movie studio that you probably have not heard of, and yet they've produced over 150 movies. They've been around for 23 years. Let me read you some of the titles that they've released. The Class of Nukem High. Surf Nazis Must Die.
Whoa.
And of course, The Toxic Avenger.
Ooh. How you doing?
In our audience today, yes. I'm talking about Troma Films. Troma Films, the great studio that brings you the best in B-movies. And we have three lovely B-actresses from the B-movies that Troma produces. Please welcome Debbie Rochon, who plays Nest, Juliet's nurse, in Tromeo and Juliet. Tiffany Shepis, who plays Peter in Tromeo and Juliet. And Veronica Barrow, an actress in training who will be in a future film.
Oh, Kabuki Man NYPD.
Well, thank you very much. I have a trauma diploma. And what is this for?
That's for you.
I think I'll use this to train little Porker over there. There we go. Okay.
Well, please,
yes. Oh, well, thank you very much. Oh,
signed by all of us.
Well, thank you very much. Sit down, you guys. All right, explain to those people who may not even know, what is a B movie, and what does it mean to be a B movie actress?
Well, basically, a B movie is usually a lower budgeted movie, something under $1 million, say. And it could also be a certain genre like science fiction, fantasy, horror. That's basically how it's separated.
But the movies that you're involved in are sort of gory, sexy, sensational, right?
Well, trauma movies, they're gory and sexy, but it's more campy and fun, really.
At the same time, but there are monsters in them. I mean, when you go to an audition, well, of course, you have to be attractive and, you know, sexually appealing, I'm sure, right? But do they ask you to do things like scream? So, like, when the monster comes, I mean, could you do it for me now? I want to see how each of you scream. Because I know there's a lot of these movies. Schoolgirl Screamers was a trauma film that I knew.
Right.
And everybody was,
Do that so
right, well. But really, I could be a B-actor.
You should be a B-movie actor. That's your day.
comes the villain.
I'm going to erase you, Mike. Well, my little cookie, here, choke on this cookie.
That's very mean of you, Richard.
I'm going to put you on the wheel of torture, my dear. Are you the one in training? No, you did the movie, right?
No, it's
incredible how wide your mouth got. I can see you. Wait. Can we just see that one more time? Because, I mean, that was one more time.
You know, Richard, I really want to say something before we go on any further.
I know.
I really want to say something before we go on.
What, that you're a classically trained actress?
No, I want to say hi to the Toxic Avenger and Sergeant Boogeyman, YBD.
Right. Amen.
Okay.
Two very big stars in Romeo and Juliet.
All right, but wait a second. Some of you guys are classically trained actors. You played Shakespeare.
You were
Shakespearean. What were you in? What were you?
I was in Hamlet. I was in Twelfth Night. I was in All's Well That Ends Well. I've done some.
Do you know that I was a Shakespearean actor?
I studied at Yale.
I have a degree from Yale Drama School. Now.
Really? You studied with Meryl Streep.
And you studied at the actor studio where all the best actors study.
That's right.
All right, now, when you look at how you're dressed now, look at these boots. Give me a break. When you look at, I know, right, that's something out of like Charlie's Express.
Give me some of that.
Yeah, maybe.
You know what, but there are moments people come up to me and they go, you're a classically trained actor. How could you be a talk show host? Do you see this as a stepping stone? Do you enjoy it as an end to itself? What is your feeling about?
I love doing all B films, all the whole genre. It's wonderful. Trauma movies like Romeo and Juliet, the new film.
Well, it's good thing you mentioned that. Romeo and Juliet, we have a clip from this movie, right. A modern adaptation of Shakespeare's classic. Only this one has body piercing tattoos and punk rockers. Let's take a look at that.
Now you're going too far. Damn pigs bouncing off the cars while Long Island families are singing Found a Peanut. Well, he found a peanut, all right, honey. He found a peanut of death. Now tell me who did this. Tell me now, or God help me. I'll b- nose off.
Troy, how cute did it.
Oh, yeah. But Troy, what light for you on the window break? I am so sorry, but we've run out of time here. Romeo and Juliet, the name of the movie. Is it going to play in the movies, or do you have to rent it at the video store?
It's going to come to the theaters in the spring.
It's going to actually be in the theater, and you'll hear them all scream in theatrical dramatic context. Don't go away. We'll be back. More fun, more surprises on The Richie Show. It's so nice.
So there you go. Richard Basho, a syndicated talk show in New Jersey, which makes sense, you know, Trauma in a local sort of New Jersey, New York-ish area there. It aired from 1992 to 1996 and was shown nationally on the UPN station. Now, I remember UPN, but I don't remember this show at all.
Yeah, I remember UPN. I don't remember anything that was on UPN, but
Yeah, so this is kind of cool. This reminds me of that Sci-Fi Buzz segment we talked about.
Yeah, that was cool.
Mike Stevens.
And that's on YouTube too,
Yeah, and who knows how many pieces of strange lost media they were promoting Trauma stuff on. I mean, a lot, I'm sure.
But I'm sure Trauma was like any time they could get in front of a camera and do something, they probably would.
For sure. So, fun little segment. So be sure to, leave a like on that guy's YouTube video. I'll link it down below. Anytime I have like the YouTube links for any of the stuff, I'll put it in the show sort of description, and you guys can always go and give a thumbs up to those people who saved. I think this actually came from Debbie Rochon's YouTube channel, I think. So I think she put it up there. The next thing I have here, another strange odds and ends, and I think Tiffany herself sent this to me, because when we were sort of finding out about all these music videos that she was in, she actually sent this, and this was, I don't know if I'd call it a real music video. This was a film called Death for Sale, shot in 1995, 1996, directed by Stephen Chase. The YouTube description said a music video version of a short film made before Tiffany Shepis became Troma's leading lady. Tiffany plays a detective named Sneaker who dreams of murder involving kinky death portraits. So I have been trying to get some information about this. Now, we can't play this video on the show because the music to it is actually a Garbage song, like the band Garbage.
Okay,
not the
sure.
song Garbage, but like the band Garbage. So you hear Shirley Manson singing to it. Right, and of course, we'll get flagged immediately if that happens. But I'll play, like, as we're talking here, some clips of this. And I'm unsure if this was an actual film that this director just sort of decided to chop into a music video and for fun kind of put this Garbage song over, or if this is what it was originally supposed to be. It's kind of weird. Now, we were talking that we've had so much stuff going on. We watched a lot of this stuff over a span of time here.
Yeah.
So our minds aren't as fresh on some of this stuff. But do you remember checking out this weird little music video thing?
Yeah, I thought it was cool. And like you said, immediately the thing you notice is that it's Garbage, the band. And so you're like, well, this must be kind of a fan thing or something, because I don't think Garbage was officially involved in it. So, but yeah. It's cool, but it's sort of like one of those cool pieces of art. Now it's very common to go on YouTube and you find someone compiling a piece of little sort of video art based on things that they like or using things that they like. And this is like, you know, predates all that. So it's kind of neat.
Yeah, it's very avant-garde, a lot of weird sort of symbolism and imagery and stuff going on. I think it's in black and white. Again, you don't hear Tiffany speak at all or anything because, you know, it's just Shirley Manson singing over the top of it. But it's kind of cool, and I would have had no knowledge of this had Tiffany herself not sent it over. So that's kind of another cool thing, is seeing this weird stuff that you would have – I mean, it's not on IMDb or anything like that. So, you know, this would be something that could be lost to time. Could be buried down in YouTube and no one would ever know about it if someone wasn't like, hey, check this out. So that was kind of cool. And again, I'll link it down below. The next odds and ends. Now, back on episode 2, we show the Conker's Bad Fur Day commercial.
Pass out partying last night. He gets up on the bar and starts spraying all over these bikers. Then we get back here and he goes all night. He's paying for it now.
See this squirrel go on a bender and you'll never look at squirrels the same way again. Cocker's Bad Fur Day.
Oh yeah, you like that?
Rated M for mature.
You want some more? I'll give you some more, baby. Oh yeah.
And we sort of talked about that a little bit, but I met when I think Tiffany posted on her Facebook our last episode and told a bunch of people, hey, check out what these guys are doing. So thank you very much, Ms. Shepis, for directing your fans to check this out. We really, really appreciate it. And I was just kind of looking at the comments in it, and all the comments were very like, oh, wow, this was cool. But there was an individual named Francisco Javier Walmeyer Fernandez. I hope I pronounced his name right. I apologize if I did not. And he apparently used to be the old webmaster for Tiffany Shepis's website. And he actually provided a ton of footage that he had of Tiffany Shepis. Well, that's how we found out a lot about these music videos that she was in, because he's like, here, and provided a bunch of stuff. But on this like long reel of stuff that he provided us was behind the scenes of the Conker's Bad Fur Day music or TV commercial. And so I'll just go ahead and play this. And then, you know, it's just music playing over the top of some behind the scenes, but you can check out Tiffany Shepis, getting makeup done and doing stuff behind the scenes right now.
Thank you.
thank you, Francisco Javier, for sending us that little tidbit of behind the scenes stuff. That's fun. Conker's Bad Fur Day, behind the scenes. That's the odds and ends. So now we're gonna get into the meat of this episode, and we're gonna start with the music videos because okay. We have a bunch of movies to talk about. Yeah. We'll start with the music videos. The music videos are something else. Now, I personally had no idea that Tiffany Shepis was in any music videos.
Do you me neither. No. And I, you know, a couple of these videos I remember from, you know, MTV back in the day, but I don't, you know, I didn't have that intersection of awareness to even know about it. Yeah.
Yeah. I had no idea. So again, this was what was kind of cool about this episode. I think I'd seen Delta Delta Die. I know I'd seen that. Mm-hmm. A couple of the movies I had seen, but the vast majority of stuff on this episode, completely new to me. I was like, wow, this is just kind of cool stuff. As a fan of Tiffany Shepis, it's like a treasure trove of stuff you had no idea existed. Now that I've seen these music videos, it makes total sense that I would have never known she was in them, because none of these bands are anything I was ever
I was going to ask, like the intro, because these things run the gamut. They really run the gamut of genres and types of music. And I have pretty far in wide ranging tastes in music, but I think of you as someone with a little bit of a narrower band in what you like. Did you encounter anything that was sort of outside of your wheelhouse that you actually enjoyed here?
No.
Okay. Fair enough.
No.
Fair enough.
And we'll talk about each one of them individually, because again, you know, obviously with YouTube, I can't play the music or anything
right.
on these. So I'll basically just kind of be showing clips and we'll be sort of talking over them. But she's barely in these.
Yeah, there's like kind of a Where's Waldo aspect to it. Like, you know, where? Oh, okay. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. I think it's a Little Nas or something. And I might have even asked her, like, where are you in this? Because I watched the video multiple times. And that's the thing. I gave it the old college try. I'm like where is she? When we get to the Wu-Tang Clan video,
I did not find her.
Yeah, and I wish I would have known.
So it wasn't a hardship to re-listen to it, but yeah.
So, well, the first one we're going to talk about, we'll just go kind of like in date order.
Okay.
This one is 1996, Roughneck featuring Yvonne, Move Your Body.
Let's go.
And this was in Francisco Javier. This was the first video on his reel that he sent me. And there was like 14 minutes of this video. And I'm watching it. And I'm like, what in the world? And then there's like 5 minutes of just behind the scenes of her like dancing around. Mm-hmm. With, I don't know, waters like spraying on her or something. I can't remember, but that's it. Roughneck featuring Yvonne. And I think she said this was never like officially released something like that. But I don't know. What did you think of this? This is just her kind of like
dancing. Yeah, I like it. I mean, you know what? You can't complain about this. Seems fine.
I mean, I can complain about it. The music is awful to me. It's awful to me.
Okay. I like it.
So yeah, you know, you could watch. Here's some footage of Tiffany Shepis in 1996 in Roughneck featuring Yvonne. So yeah, Move Your Body, Jeff. Do you want to move your body?
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely, I do. For sure.
Okay, cool. So the next one we're going to is we're fast forwarding to 2000. Uh-huh. So if she has done any music videos between 96 and 2000 and anyone knows of them, please send them our way so that we can watch them. But we skip ahead 4 years to the Wu-Tang Clan's
Travel Kit. Hell yeah.
Now you're a fan of the Wu-Tang Clan,
for
right?
For sure. Oh yeah, absolutely.
Okay. Not my thing growing up. Definitely not my thing. But again, I watched these videos and this video was long.
Man, yeah, it is.
This was like one of those...
Yeah, they have like several members and each one has to get their verse in. So their songs are long sometimes. Yeah, for sure. Yeah. I watched this twice. I couldn't find her.
I watched it like four times. Okay. Like I was really trying, and I do not like the music whatsoever. And I was trying. I was looking at every background dancer shaking their ass, mm-hmm. and I'm like, "Where is she?" Because you know, first you're looking for the short haircut,
right?
So it's like, okay, who's got the short haircut? Couldn't find anybody. I'm like, "Where is she?" Ultimately, I reached out to her, and she's like, "Oh, she got cast in the video, but she never showed up for the shoot." So she wasn't actually in the Wu-Tang Clan Gravel Pit video. She went to shoot something else at the time. So, Tiffany, I watched this video. It was like 40 minutes. The video is like 12 minutes long or something.
Wu-Tang still rules. I don't regret anything.
My memory of Wu-Tang from the 90s and early 2000s was Old Dirty Bastard, right? He was all over the news. And I do like in this video when they show Old Dirty Bastard, it's just like hands behind an ancient jail or made of bones.
Yep.
So that was kind of funny. But yeah, she's not in Wu-Tang Clan's gravel pit. So we gave it the college try. Next up, 2000. Now, this is a band. I never liked this band, but this was probably the band closest to something I would listen to on this list. And that is The Offspring's original Prankster from 2000. Now, I remember our friend DJ, who did the music for the intro to Gorefest at Tiffany's. That's one of his songs that he graciously allowed us to use for the intro. He was a big fan of The Offspring. I remember Pretty Fly for a White Guy and stuff like that. They kind of were more punk, right? Before they kind of hit it big with these poppier, catchier things.
Yeah, I don't want to go off on a tangent, but I had the Offspring album Smash, and then the follow-up to that was called Ixnay on the Ombre, and those two records I loved. I had those in the mid-90s when I was a teenager, and I think they're awesome. I would still pop either one of those on today and listen to it all the way through, no skips. I think they're great. Now, as they went along, they kind of, I don't know whether I outgrew them or what, but it's sort of like there's only so much of that you need, and what they have there in those records is awesome and I love it, but I don't need any more than that. So I haven't kept up with them in beyond that.
Yeah. I remember they got really big in the late 90s.
Sure.
Super, super big. And I was never into pop punk, that kind of thing. I don't know if they would strictly be considered pop punk, but I was never into that kind of stuff. I was listening to Nine Inch Nails and Marilyn Manson.
Yeah.
That's what I was into at the time. I wasn't into any of this kind of stuff, but I watched this and I'm looking for her, and I feel kind of uncomfortable saying this because I'm scanning all these girls, because all these videos, it's just scantily clad women dancing around in the background. And I think they're on the Santa Monica Pier. If I know my peers in Southern California, I think it's the Santa Monica Pier. And I look over to the right and I just see this ass sticking out, like a girl sticking her ass out on the pier. And my eyes just drawn to it. And then boom, it's Tiffany Shepis. Okay. And I'm like, oh no, I feel bad. It's I just
well,
see
there you go.
That's what caught my eye and drifted away from Dexter over to her. And then of course you see her, she's got the short hair like she always did back in that time. You see her popping up, I think it was it Red Man or something guests on this.
Hell yeah.
And she's in shallow depth of field over his left shoulder as he's rapping. So you see her dancing around every once in a while. We'll go ahead and put some clips in here that you can kind of see it, but she's much easier to find than in some of this stuff that we're going to talk about.
Yeah.
So Offspring, Original Prankster. How do you like that tune? You a fan of that one?
Yeah, it's all right. It's all right. And then, maybe we'll touch back on it when we get to the movie Detour later in the episode, but there's this trope in some of these Offspring things, this and the not present here, but the Pretty Fly for a White Guy. There's this trope that sort of existed in the early mid 2000s that has gone away. It was a thing for a point in time, but it's kind of funny how I don't know if it's become something. It's something that we wouldn't do nowadays. It's kind of interesting.
Oh yeah. My notes on Detour, and we'll get to it. I was like, well, we'll get there.
Yeah.
I'll keep my powder dry on that
one.
Okay. Next up, Little Zane. None Tonight from 2000.
That one's so funny. It's a good one.
I watched this multiple times.
Yeah,
I had no idea where she was.
Yeah.
I was like, where is she? And then she actually sent me a screenshot. She is the girl in the black and pink wig that's wrestling with the other girl.
I'll have to pull it back up.
It's so blink and you miss it, right? Uh-huh. I'm just like, I would have never known. But yeah, again, this music's not my thing. One thing I was realizing as I'm watching all these music videos, as you know, YouTube has their algorithm, right? So as you watch videos, start throwing other things up in your feed. And I'm like, oh my God, I don't want my perfectly curated YouTube feed to suddenly pop up Little Zane videos from 15 years ago or something. But yeah, so she's barely in that one. Next up, we got Britney Spears, Lucky, from 2000. So 2000, she was just hitting the music video scene, and it was a big deal apparently back then. So Lucky, now I didn't know she was in this.
I couldn't find her. I admit. No,
couldn't find her. And you're not going to be able to find her because she told me that she is a shadow. She is Britney Spears' shadow.
Okay.
So she was a stand-in for Britney Spears in certain parts. And you can see her, Tiffany Shepp, is a shadow in the thing, but not her. She's not actually in it. So she did send this awesome picture of her with Britney Spears.
Oh, cool.
On set. So that's pretty sweet. And man, I remember Britney Spears being so big back then.
Oh yeah.
I mean, cultural sensation. Uh-huh. Jeez. Now I'm nostalgic for like TRL.
Britney Spears is here. So we're going to bring her out and meet her for the very first time. All of that coming up next on Total Request Live.
Oh yeah.
And all
of
that stuff back then. I used to, those were simpler times, good times. All right. So yeah, barely in that one. So we're not really going to count that. Now this one was interesting to me. Run DMC's Rock Show 2001 featuring Steven Jenkins, of course, of Third Eye Blind. I love the first Third Eye Blind album. I think it's fantastic.
Yeah, yeah.
I love it. Mm-hmm. Steven Jenkins didn't seem to fit on this, though. Something about his voice didn't really work. I don't know if it was the mix or he just doesn't have that kind of rock voice, but Run DMC Rock Show. She shows up around the 2:40 mark. And do you remember this one? Do you remember her sort of moment in this?
Yep, yep. Just pops in there and there she is. Yeah, it's great.
Yeah, she pops in there. She's in the blonde wig. And then, like, she's just dancing around in slow motion because all these videos, it's always slow motion. Mm. But the girls are dancing, of course. And then, like, I don't know, 10 seconds later, somebody behind her pulls the blonde wig off of her head and she like yells and that's it. and that's it. That's all she's in. But she's cool. She got her little moment. I mean, that's probably a cool thing to be like, look, I got a 5-second moment in this Run DMC Rock Show video.
Yeah. I mean, I love Run DMC and I love Third Eye Blind for that matter. So yeah, this is great.
Did you like this song though?
I mean, it's a lesser work. Let's be honest.
It is fair. All right, next up, we're not done with the music videos yet, ladies and gentlemen. We got The Calling, Stigmatized from 2001. Now, fun fact about The Calling, the lead singer of this band is Charles Band's son.
Oh, I did not know that.
Yeah, and I first learned about this in Charles Band's book.
Okay.
Because I read his autobiography or whatever that he put out a couple years back, and he was mentioning about how his son was in this rock band called The Calling. And then when I saw this in the reel, I was like, oh, okay, this makes sense. Yeah, I know, I think Tiffany's friends with Charles Band. It would make sense that she shows up in his son's band's music video. So this one, okay.
It's closer to what you would be interested in, right?
No.
No?
What do you call it? This wouldn't be called like butt rock, because that would be more like
like Def Leppard or something, or I don't know.
I don't know. This is not something I'd be interested in at all.
Okay.
The video, I will admit, confuses me. And I'm one of these weird people that does not listen to lyrics of songs.
Yeah, I'm similar.
I have tried to explain this to my fiance, who just doesn't understand it, because she connects with music through the lyrics. Mm-hmm. It's primarily the lyrics and the music that accompanies it that really, you know, hits her and makes her feel passionate about it. And when I tell her, I'm like, I don't listen to lyrics at all. I try to recite lyrics to like a Nirvana song and I'm getting them completely wrong, because I only listen to lyrics in the sense of the singers, the melody, and how they are singing the lyrics.
I'm right there with you. I remember being a young guy and having like a Tool's Undertow album and having a couple of favorite songs off that. And like, yeah, this rules. I'm doing my paper out as a kid, you know, whatever. Listening to my Walkman. And then like, I read the lyrics. I'm like, holy cow, what am I, what
Wait,
am I Stink doing?
Fist is about what?
What am I doing? So yeah, no, yeah. I'm with you.
Okay, good. So next time you see Alyssa, you tell her that I'm not a weirdo, that this is an actual thing. So this one, it's weird. She's with this guy. I know they're out like on sand dunes at some point in time. Half the time she's got like a scarf wrapped around her head. You can't see her face. Sometimes it's off. Are they getting married? Is it like, cause I don't know, personally, I have no
idea. It's open to interpretation.
I have no idea what this music video is about. If anyone does, leave a message down below. Put a comment. What is this about? Because I wasn't listening to the lyrics, and it's just a lot of like montage. Like maybe the stigma, like stigmatize. It's like an interracial relationship or something. Maybe that is the stigmatized. I don't know. I don't know what he's talking about. But that's The Calling. You have any comments on this one? Like,
Who knew that Charles Band had a son who was also making art? I didn't know that.
Decent singer.
Yeah.
He's a pretty good singer. Sure. Like, yeah, he's not bad. Nothing. He's not bad. And the last one, finally, we're going to talk about. We're half an hour into the episode,
folks. Hilarious, this one is.
Destiny's Child's Nasty Girl from 2002.
I mean, Beyonce, so Jeff, one of the biggest stars on planet Earth for many years now at this point. So, you know, here we go.
For sure. Funny thing about this. So, well, Jeff, set it up. What role does Tiffany play in Nasty Girl?
This is, and I feel like you could do a whole episode maybe on this video and sort of like what it means or how you interpret it and like, you know, the interplay between women when they're, you know, dealing with one another. But there's.
Feels a little slut shamey, is what it feels
Yeah, it's of its time. I mean, I don't, you probably have the year, the specific year when this was, but.
2002.
So, yeah, it's many, you know, 20 years ago at this point, things were a little bit different. But yeah, so they're Destiny's Child, Beyonce and Kelly, and I don't know the other one's name. I'm sorry. Kelly was my favorite. I'm Team Kelly.
All right. They, I remember him, Freddy versus Jason.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Very.
Where Freddy like chops her nose off.
Exactly.
Or
exactly.
Got your nose.
So. The song is about nasty girls, like girls who are kind of trashy. This isn't me saying this. This is Destiny's
Child. Beyonce
Child.
Saying it. Yeah. Beyonce.
Take it up with Beyonce if you have a problem with any of this. Okay. Evaluating, you know, judging these other girls who are maybe portraying themselves in a way that's a little bit unflattering or a little bit too forward. And Tiffany is portraying a trashy, nasty girl, and she's walking down the street, and she's so funny. I mean, her comedic.
It's hilarious.
Her comedic chops really come through in this video. She's very funny. So
this
she's
is where
the
Trauma Edge TV stuff came into play.
Yeah. She's right very here. Funny. So she's walking down the street as the nasty girl, the trashy girl, and Destiny's Child, Beyonce, is telling her, no, you got to clean up your act. You got to quit dressing that way. You got to quit behaving that way. You got to straighten up. And so, you know, there's this little plot line through the video where she ends up in the office of the denastification team or something.
It's the nasty zapper. The nasty they zapper. Put her into the nasty zapper.
Yeah. They have to change her, you know. And they do. And then,
problematic.
Yeah.
Problematic, as our friend Rachel would say. Yeah. So she goes into the nasty zapper and she comes out looking real nice.
Looking real she's classy, you know.
Fancy, classy, and, you know, Beyonce. And I think there's a moment at the end where she's dancing with Destiny's Child with the group of
and
nasty
there's
girls.
A couple other nasty characters who are also trashy and also get put into the nasty zapper. And so, you know, they help a lot of people.
So when I watched, I was laughing at this
funny.
I was watching. She's got the whale tail and everything. I mean, it's like the classic late 90s, early 2000s. Trashy sort of girl. She's like in the bikini top and whatnot. And the funniest thing happened after this, because YouTube will autoplay stuff after it. So I'm watching Nasty Girl, and this whole thing is Beyonce and the rest of Destiny's Child talking down to these women. Put on some fucking clothes, ladies. No guy wants you when your ass is hanging out and your boobs are popping out. Nobody wants us. Put on your clothes. I shit you not. I'll try to find the video. I'll try to find this. The next video that plays is Destiny's Child, and they're all naked. They're all like covering themselves naked and singing. And I'm just like, this is a weird world.
Yeah,
we're
I mean,
in.
Come on. Have it both ways. Have your cake and eat it too there, so Beyonce.
Lost all respect for Beyonce. She didn't stick to her guns there. She didn't go classy on her music video. So don't know what to say. But that is funny. This is probably the video that I'd say she's in the most.
Yeah, for sure.
Of all of these, for sure. So if you're going to watch any of these, I'll link them all in the show notes. Like I said, if you're going to watch any of them, watch Nasty Girl. She's right up. At the very beginning, she's walking in slow motion down the street wearing, you know, her nasty girl clothing. And it's pretty funny, if nothing else. Yeah. So
I think what's cool about the music videos, and you know, I don't know her, you know, the, her journey or what it was like when she was working as a young person, but like it portrays that she was always out there hustling and working. She wasn't just like only going to be in movies or only going to take these things. I mean, she was always out there working, whether it's just a bit part in a music video or it's like a, you know, a title role in a movie. She's out there working and hustling, which, you know,
much respect.
Yeah.
Much respect. And I'm sure, you know, if we ever have her on the show, you know, I hope to ask this, but I'm sure just from seeing other interviews that came from Troma, right?
Yeah.
Troma instills the hustle, because that's what Troma has to do, is they have to hustle to get their stuff out there and get people, you know, interest and eyeballs on it. So any final thoughts on the music videos, Jeff, or shall we move on to the movies?
Yeah, let's go. Let's get moving.
The movies. Okay. Now, this was a movie. The first movie we're going to talk about is something called All for Money from 2003. Now, this was one when we were initially starting this sort of show and kind of doing initial, you know, research on it, you know, planning out the episodes, you know, episode 1 through 6, whatever. I saw this. We're going in chronological order by date. This in 2003, and I was like, Billy Drago, you say, because it simply says All for Money, starring Tiffany Shepis and Billy Drago. There's barely anything else on the IMDb page. As I went through every single, and I have a spreadsheet, Jeff's seen it, where every single movie that Tiffany Shepis has been, I went to IMDb, I found everything, put all the details in it. There was another movie from 2013, like 10 years later. It's a slightly different title, but in a different director, but it also says it stars Tiffany Shepis and Billy Drago. Now, I was very excited. I know you were, because we love Billy Drago, correct?
Everybody loves Billy Drago.
Billy Drago is amazing. And I...
Singular kind of guy, yeah.
For sure, for sure. And it's like, well, man, you put Billy Drago in a film with Tiffany Shepis and you have my attention. Unfortunately, it seems like this movie was never made, because we could not find it anywhere.
I was going to say, you're going to have to cover for me, because I didn't see this one.
No, I didn't find it. You couldn't find it. Nobody could find it. I reached out to Ms. Shepis herself and I said, hey, what's going on with this? Is there any way to get it? And according to her, she believes it was never filmed. So unfortunately, it does not look like All for Money was ever, you know, something that was made. And LionDB, as you say, people can put whatever they want up on LionDB. So whoever put that in there.
Yeah, like who did that data entry? Because that's what's funny to me.
Yeah, because I can update IMDb. I can create entries on IMDb. It's kind of like Wikipedia in a sense. Pretty much anyone can put anything up there. I could create a completely fake movie and say starring Tiffany Shepis and put it in there. But yeah, whoever put that in there, what are you doing, man? You're throwing us off. You're getting our hopes up and you're crushing our dreams. So All for Money, we're going to cross that off the list. Unfortunately, because it does not appear to our knowledge and to Ms. Shepis's knowledge, doesn't seem to exist unless she's completely blanked it out. But I would think that if you were in a movie opposite Billy Drago, that would be something unforgettable.
Yeah, right? I would think so. Now, like, it's funny because, like, my day job, I think about, like, what I do. And I could see myself forgetting something that I did at my day job, you know, last year or something. You know, it wasn't that big of a deal. So if your day job, like Ms. Shepis, is you're just an actress, maybe you just forget about things that you did because that's your job. It's routine for you at a certain point or on a certain level. So I could see, you know, but Billy Drago, I just feel like you would remember that.
Yeah, I think so. And it's not without precedent that she would forget a movie she's in, because I think it was on episode 2, we talked about Conte, that Indian film.
Yeah.
And somebody at a convention, they were bringing her DVDs to sign for Conte.
Yeah.
She's like, I'm not in this movie. And then she went to like Quentin Tarantino's theater and watched it. And there she is on the arm of the gangster and had no idea. So maybe this Billy Drago thing exists out there and it's just sort of gone into ether. If anyone knows about All for Money or the story behind it or anything, or if the director out there is watching this, please reach out to us, outpostunknown@gmail.com. Tell us a little bit about it. We want to know.
I love it. I love the lost media angle. It's fascinating to me.
Yeah. So, and we are trying, folks. We are trying to find all this lost media, and we succeeded today on something, which you'll, that's another tease to stick around for the end of the show. Now, let's get into the one that I do distinctly remember watching back in the day, Delta Delta Die, mm-hmm. from 2003, directed by Devin Hamilton. Tiffany plays a character named Patrice. So set up Delta Delta Die. What is this all about, and what's her role in it?
So it's one of these, like, I assume this was straight to video back in those days.
Well, I'm sure.
So it's a sorority. So Tiffany is a member of the sorority, the Delta Delta Pies. And they, it turns out, their sorority mother is Julie Strain, and it turns out that they're
rest in peace, Julie Strain.
It turns out that they're cannibals. They capture unwitting men who maybe kind of have it coming. You know, they're a little too forward down at the bar or something. They're a little sleazy to the girls, and then they, well, I guess what? We're gonna take you home and chop you up and eat you. And not only do they eat the men, but they also have these bake sales where they sell their Delta Delta pies to everyone around. So they unwittingly turn everybody on campus into cannibals because they come get the baked goods and the food at the bake sale. And it's so delicious. There's just nothing else like it. And so they've turned everyone into cannibals. And it's just kind of the story of this sorority going about their cannibalistic ways while trying to stay, you know, far enough under the radar that they don't get interfered with. But also, like, you know, how long can you do that while you're literally eating people, you know? So that's basically the story.
Yeah, kind of over. It feels Troma-esque.
Yeah,
you know, it's in that.
It's a
vein
little thin.
Of,
I mean, you
like
know.
Sort of over the top. Like there's a moment I wrote down some notes here. Like the opening scene is really wild. It's like, you know, it's this guy and this girl. They're about to get it on, whatever. And she like bites his dick off or something like that. And then the subsequent scene is Julie Strain at the head of the table, and it's like Tiffany Shepis and then all the other actors around that. And there's this super serious moment, right? Because one of the girls is about to get in trouble.
Yeah.
And you remember, like, she has to tell all the girls that she ate a penis.
The penis. I ate the penis.
Oh. It's like, that's the most forbidden thing. You can't do that.
Forbidden. And I think they actually mentioned, like, quote, she ate a penis. That is unforgivable.
Yeah.
Mother, forgive me, but we shouldn't set a precedent here. Grounding is not a severe enough punishment for such an infraction. I mean, she ate a penis. That's unforgivable.
So, and they have like a penis chant and everything like that.
The penis is filled with germs and sperm.
I think Julie Strain says something like, you know, it's barely edible if it's cooked properly, let alone just eating it raw sort of thing. That's the kind of humor that we're dealing with in this movie. Very Troma-esque, I would think, or at least Troma-adjacent. Tiffany's got a couple interesting scenes. Like, she's got that scene when they go into the bar, and there's those two, they were talking about, like, oh, those uptown bitches moving in on our territory.
Those uptown bitches are moving in on our territory. This is on.
They're like fighting over these dudes in the bar. There's a strip poker scene. That's kind of like a centerpiece, I think, because you know, Tiffany Shepis is dominating this strip poker. She's like, everybody is getting, you know, losing their shirts and everything except for her. But then she does kind of like a strip tease sort of thing before Julie Strain comes in. And doesn't she have like these guys like suck on her boobs or something?
Yeah, she's, it's
like,
a little...
yeah, like suck on these, like,
why don't you come over here and give mommy a big kiss right here? Suck those titties.
Were you into this back in 2002 or 2003 when it came out?
Because, you know,
I think our tastes have changed.
Yeah, that's the funny thing, is that I think about the trajectory and the evolution of my tastes. And back when this was new, I probably would have rented it and watched it. I think I did, as a matter of fact. And I probably thought it was okay. You know what I mean? And now I would expect myself to be so far over it and not really like it at all. But I don't know if it's nostalgia or it's, you know, all this time has passed and finding enjoyment in the things of your youth or whatever. But now I watched it and I actually did, you know, I wouldn't say it's high art by any means, but I had fun watching it.
Okay.
More like not anything about it, but just like the whole package, the sum of its parts. I'm like, okay, yeah, I remember that kind of thing. I remember this kind of thing. I remember this type of DVD, being on the shelf at whatever the video store was. And so for those reasons, I liked the movie and Julie Strain and Brink Stevens and all these people. But yeah, it's not like something that I would actually recommend on the basis of liking it, but it is a good example of the sort of thing that I liked when I was that age. Yeah.
Okay. I'll just ask a question here. On the first episode, when we were talking about Troma, and we were talking about Troma's aesthetic, and you know, it's not for everybody. It's kind of like an acquired taste, like their sort of thing. And we sort of commented, like, some of this stuff holds up a lot better than we would have expected. Mm-hmm. What separates something like Delta Delta Die from something like Troma? These general type of things that are kind of like, you know, immature comedy sort of stuff it's more about, you know, showing boobs and being over the top. Like, what sets something like this apart from like a Troma thing, or they all kind of fall in the exact same sort of pool to you?
Well, I'll be clear and say that I think the Troma stuff is way better than something like Delta Delta Die, for example. The Troma stuff has a voice, clearly. I don't know if I could define that voice in words for you, but you know what it is. It looks filmic, for one thing.
They have messages to them.
They have a little bit of messaging. They have an intersection of actual sort of like, I don't want to say scholarly, but like well-trained filmmaking involved in the Troma stuff, certainly when Lloyd Kaufman's involved, that is not necessarily present in something like a Delta Delta Die. So the Troma stuff, it's like all the goofiness and all the wackiness and the topless women and all of that stuff, but also with a real craftsmanship to it and a voice. And so that stuff is a little bit elevated despite its lowbrow writing and content. And Delta Delta Die has the stuff like the gags and the women and all of that, but it doesn't necessarily have those things that elevate it. Yeah.
Yeah. I think, and we'll talk about this also when we get to Detour, I think, because they're similar films in terms of how they present their characters as sort of over the top stereotypes and things of that nature. I think we might have even touched on this with episode 3 when we're talking about Vinyl Dolls and Embrace the Darkness 3 and whatnot, is what I really am struck by when I'm watching these is when Tiffany Shepis is not on screen, I lose all interest.
Yeah, yeah.
So it's just kind of like, you know, I'm just kind of like waiting for the next Tiffany Shepis scene to show up. And, you know, we'll probably say this ad nauseum as we go through her filmography, but I think that's one of the things.
Yeah.
These filmmakers lucked out, I think, in for casting her in a lot of this stuff, because, you know, I think she does elevate these things, maybe not sort of like in a super artistic way in which like this is now a very film that has meaning and depth and all of that stuff. But just in terms of the entertainment value of these movies and watchability of a lot of these movies. But man, when she's not on screen, it's like I'm laughing when she's doing the strips tease scene and that song, Get Your Groove On, Get Your Groove On, Get Your Groove On. I mean, I'm laughing this entire time. And then Julie Strain shows up. And I love Julie Strain, don't get me wrong. But then the film just grinds to a halt.
Yeah.
Until she's back on
screen. Yeah, you're 100% right. You're exactly right. Like, why did we watch this? Because Tiffany was in it. We wouldn't necessarily, I'm not interested in watching every Julie Strain movie.
That's
you know,
true.
With all due respect. I mean, certainly. Yeah. So, yeah, you're absolutely right.
Yeah, and that's interesting. You know, these movies live on in perpetuity because certain actors are in them, and people will just watch them because of that. So, so that is any other comments about Delta Delta Die?
Yeah, I have a few comments. One, this is just a stray thought I had while I was watching the movie. At some point during the movie, I was sort of laughing to myself, and I thought, and again, it's been a while, it's been, you know, a couple weeks since I watched it, but it was like, I had the thought, there's no protagonist in this movie. Maybe it's like the guy who's the secretary or assistant to the dean of the college where all this is going down is kind of the protagonist, but there's not really a protagonist. The sorority is these bad guy cannibals. And then there's like some other people around the edges who are just also not really, you know, they're just not your hero. There's not really a good guy in the movie, so to speak. So I don't know if that's like a failure of the script writing or what, but it was kind of something. It's just a thought I had while I was watching it. And the other comment, and this is a stray thing, maybe Matt can pop up the graphic, but the poster to this, at least one of them, I'm sure there's a few different pieces of key art. It's hilariously bad photoshopping. There's a great, the one that I'm thinking of anyway, it's like Tiffany in the center. It's a great shot of her. And there's two other actresses behind her, but it's like she's photoshopped to be holding a really fake looking silly chainsaw. And like her hands are not really holding a chainsaw. It's like on a strap around her shoulder. It's very funny looking. And the girl behind her is holding a knife, but she's very clearly not holding the knife. It's just sort of like photoshopped awkwardly behind her fingers in the image. It's very, very funny, like early 2000s Photoshop work on the cover of I suppose the DVD when it came out. So that it's pretty funny. It's one of those things that like the longer you look at it, you notice different things and it becomes funnier and funnier.
Yeah, this is what's interesting about this cover. I'm glad you brought up the cover because you would think that Julie Strain would be on the cover.
Yeah.
Like Julie Strain was a much bigger name at that time than Tiffany Shepis. Mm-hmm. And so I would love to know the story of how that cover was created, because I remember Tiffany Shepis front and center on that. And Death Factory was the other one with Tiffany Shepis on the cover. Those are the two very vivid Tiffany Shepis movies I remember because she's front and center on those covers. But it's hilarious. It's ridiculous. The cover itself, but I'd love to know the story behind that and why they chose, you know, her as opposed to Julie Strain. You would think Julie Strain would sell the movie to distributors and stuff like, oh, Julie Strain's in this. But regardless, that is Delta Delta Die. I think it's on Tubi. I think I watched it on Tubi.
I watched it on Tubi for sure.
Okay. So, you know, if you're listening to this, you might still be on Tubi. Be sure to check that. I'll put it in the show notes if it is there. So, next up, we're going to talk about an interesting one here, not necessarily because Tiffany Shepis is in it. She's in it for like 5 seconds. But we thought the film itself was kind of interesting. This is The Ghouls from 2003, directed by Chad Farron. Now, just doing some research on this one, Chad Farron, previously with Troma, he actually directed the sex episode of Troma's Edge TV, which we took a look at in episode one of our show, Gore Fest at Tiffany's. He made this movie for $15,000, shot on mini DV tapes. He sold his 1968 Mustang to finance this movie. And there's a lot of Troma alumni in this. Trent Haga's in it, Stephen Blackheart in it, etc.
James Gunn is in this.
Yes, he is in this at the very beginning. You're right. I had completely forgotten about that. Give the little sort of brief, like what is The Ghouls about?
Oh, this is crazy. I mean, I don't want to spoil anything, but I'll stop short of saying I loved this movie, but I really liked it a lot. The best way I can describe it is if you've seen that movie Nightcrawler with Jake Gyllenhaal recently, which is not recently, but you know, in the somewhat recent past, this is kind of like that, but it predates it and it's like, you know, more grittier and horror-y, you know. Low rent, but it's this guy who is this supposed to be New York City? I can't remember, but
I think it's L.A. Yeah, I think it's Los Angeles. He's a news stringer.
Yeah, some big city, and this guy is a news stringer. Is that the term?
I think so.
He's a guy who just goes around with a camera, and this is back in the day where they had a big old giant camera. It's not everybody walking around with their iPhones like today, but a big old giant camera so that you could get the professional footage, and he's just going around hoping to catch like some horrible car accident or some police chase or something like that, get the footage and then go sell it to the local TV stations. And that's what he does for a job. He hopes to encounter the most gruesome, messed up situations he can so that he can sell that sensational footage. And then while he's doing all that, also he's kind of like strung out. He's messed up in a few different ways. He has a relationship that's screwed up. He's using drugs and whatnot. He's the other people who are his peers in this industry are also similarly messed up. They're doing drugs. They're doing engaging in reckless behavior. And while he's doing all this, he encounters some, I guess we'll call them ghouls, zombies, sort of like stereotypical zombies, weirdos eating people in a dark alley in the middle of the night. And sort of it becomes this thing where he wants to figure out what's going on with that. But while doing that, he gets, you know, caught up in it and gets into trouble. I found it really interesting. I'd never seen this before. And while I was watching it, I was like, wow, there's kind of something here, in my opinion.
Yeah, I was surprised that I liked it as much as I did. Now, Tiffany Shepis is only in this for less than 10 seconds.
Yeah, it's one of those things where she's functionally not in it, really. I mean, let's be honest.
Yeah, she plays, I guess, one of the ghouls.
Yeah.
I think she just had a baby or something. You see at the 36-minute mark, you see her, it's like a wide shot, just her laying down.
Yeah.
At the hour and 8-minute mark, you see her as a ghoul, and the lead character comes in and just like shoots her and shoots the baby ghoul. And I mean, that's it. I mean, probably less than 5 seconds she's actually in this movie. But you're right. When I was watching this movie, I was strangely engrossed in it. I mean, it's so kind of low budget, you know, made for 15 on mini DV tapes. This is what we shot The Grand Horror on, is mini DV tapes. And I was watching this, I'm like, there is something to this movie. And the one scene in particular that stands out to me is, and I apologize, I don't have the IMDb up, but the main actor in this, I thought, did a really good job. He is having a conversation with this girl because, like, his ex-girlfriend or something, and she doesn't want anything to do with him. And he's like, why don't you want anything to do with me? Why are you doing this to me? Because she's really cold to him and doesn't want him around. And she goes through this story about how she was bored one day. He went out on one of these like night crawler sort of things. She looked at this videotape he had that he was trying to sell. And it was, he was filming like these kids burning to death, and he didn't go help them. He just filmed them to get the footage, and that's why she hates him. And then he pulls a gun on her and almost shoots her in front of her kid.
Why are you doing this to
me? You want to know? You want to know, Eric, why I despise you? It was the last time I was over at your place. You had to go out on one of your important calls. So while I waited and waited, I got bored. So I dug through your tapes. You know, get a little insight on what my boyfriend does for a living. I found one called The Kids. And I watched in horror as you filmed two children trapped in a burning building screaming to you for help. But you did nothing! You did nothing, nothing!
Fuck you!
Get out of my house.
No. Come here.
What do you want from me?
I'm like, there's more to this movie. Like, even it's like you said, it's more than the sum of its parts for sure. Like, people would look at this and be like, wow, this is just kind of like a super low budget. But the director here, Chad Farron, I mean, he went for something. Like, he was trying to do something. And I think he kind of succeeded.
Yeah, it's punching above its weight. It's cool.
It's kind of cool. And I even like the end, how he did the end credits, because they were so unique.
That was neat. Like, I remember that.
Spinning, like, and it just, it's a different fit. Now, it's not for everybody. It opens with like authentic faces of death style.
I did
footage.
Not understand that that was real. And like, when I was watching this movie, I had to start it a few times just based on what was going on. I started it and then I was like, oh wait, I got to go do something else. So I restarted this movie. So I watched that opening scene like three times, not understanding what, what it really was. Yeah. So I was like, holy cow. I didn't necessarily need to do that.
Yeah. It's an actual video of a real event that happened in Los Angeles, I guess. And I guess the thing about it was, what was kind of partially inspired this movie is, you know, I used to live in California. They would always cut in when there's a high speed chase, whenever there's anything. That's just what they do there. They break into your normal television and say, watch this. Everyone knows the OJ chase, obviously, but in California, they're big on their chases. They got this news station's got them helicopters and they want to use them.
Okay.
And this was a real thing. And I guess they interrupted children's programming to show this. And it's literally a guy. He lights himself on fire and then shoots himself in the head and dies. And you see it in this movie right up to the top. So it throws you off immediately. But it's worth watching. I think so too.
And I believe this one, at least I think I watched this on Tubi also. So
yep. This is on Tubi again. If you're watching it for Tiffany Shepis, she's barely in it.
Right.
Barely at all.
Right.
But we do have the moment for the death reel, which we'll show in just a second. But she does technically die in this movie. So I've got the clip and we've added it to the Tiffany death reel. But yeah, it's interesting for what it is, mm-hmm. but not for the Tiffany aspect of it. So that's The Ghouls 2003. Moving right along, we are going to talk about Detour 2003, directed by Steve Taylor. This is an actual Asylum movie.
Right.
So it had the Asylum logo on it. This is one of their early films before they went into the Mockbusters, I think. I was
trying to like line up the time to see whether this was perhaps a Mockbuster of, for example, Wrong Turn or something. But I think this actually predates Wrong Turn with Eliza Dushku, for example. And it, it certainly predates the Alexandra Aja Hills Have Eyes, which would maybe be my closest comparison. So I think this was just an original Asylum script or movie anyway.
Now, this is an interesting one because Tiffany plays a character named Tiffany, who is marrying another woman who she calls Angel Tits.
The fam will just have to accept it or stay in Miami.
That's my Angel Tits.
That's
is that a credit? I'm looking in IMDb if there's a credit for that.
So now we should point out to everyone that there are apparently multiple versions of this film that exist. There is a version of this up on YouTube. However, it's in like Spanish.
Okay.
But it does not contain the opening prologue sequence. So the version that you found does have the opening prologue sequence, and that's the only part that Tiffany Shepis is in.
Yeah.
Because I was actually scanning through before you found the correct version. I was scanning through the YouTube version just to see, it was in Spanish, but just to see where she's at. I couldn't find her. And I'm like, what? Is this another thing where she's just in the background walking by for a second or two? But no, you found the correct version. Do you want to set up this prologue and sort of what's happening there?
There's some young people. I don't know if they're supposed to be college age, I suppose. And they're on their way to a rave, a big outdoor
party.
They're
going to get married, I think.
Like, oh, is that what they're doing? Okay.
I think their plan is to get married. And the one girl's like, oh, my parents are having a problem with it or something. Yeah, and in the opening prologue, Tiffany Shepis is going. Now, the fun fact about the opening prologue, because she's only in the opening 2 minutes, because she dies, and we'll add that to the death reel right now, everybody. There you go. There's the deaths of Tiffany Shepis this episode, and added to the death reel. It's growing, Jeff. The death reel is getting.
It's gonna be cool. It's gonna be cool by the end of it.
Yeah. So, she is wearing the shortest shorts and the tightest shorts I have ever seen. Because she gets out and she's like, "Stay in the car." You know, it's her, you know, her fiance or whatever, and then she goes up to fight this.
Kind of
like hillbilly slasher desert thing guy. And of course, he gets out his forked hook and slices her, and she dies there on the floor or on the ground, as you've just seen. The funny thing about this is the girl who's playing opposite her in this is one of her friends who was also in Ted Bundy.
Oh.
So they were in Ted Bundy together.
Okay.
And according to IMDb, it says Tiffany Shepis said she was cast after the movie was completed, which probably explains why there's multiple versions of this, because producers decided they wanted to bring a few more names to the cast.
Right.
They called her and said, quote, "Hey, how'd you like to play a lesbian gal who gets slashed up real quick?" She said she would if her friend Renee Madison Cole could play the other girl in the scene. They agreed. Next thing she knew, she was running around the desert in the heat wearing really tight shorts. And so, again, she's barely in it, just at the very beginning. You could watch the beginning of this movie, just the prologue, and not need to watch anything else in this. I did sit through it.
I did too.
This was awful.
Yeah, yeah.
Like, I don't want a dog on the filmmakers. I mean, right. We said on this, but this is one I would actively say, watch the first 2 minutes with Tiffany in it and don't watch the rest. This was so cringeworthy. The lines that they were saying, the dialogue, nothing happens in this movie except for cringy, awful dialogue, sex dialogue between all these characters for like 45 minutes. It's terrible.
That is no way for peeps to behave. Making loops of swords, sex into some bitch ass slave.
Sorry about bagging on you, Lawrence, but the only hood you go near has a car attached.
Oh, please, Larry, don't go gangster and we'll do anything.
Oh, yeah, baby. You want us to make you a white boy sandwich to make it up to you?
Oh, yeah, I roll with this.
Oh, my God, ew!
What's wrong?
It moved. Oh. I felt it.
Oh, what, you mean this? Oh, baby, that's just more flavor for y'all to save.
Tastes like microphallus.
Nothing happens in the movie, and then also when we finally get to the reveal of the villains, they don't even look cool. They just look like people. Yeah. They're just like people, but maybe their shirt's dirty or something. I don't know. So yeah, you needed a little bit of something here to punch it up, and it just isn't there. So yeah.
Yeah. This one I would not recommend checking out.
I guess the last thing, the only other thing that I'll say about Detour, and I alluded to it earlier when we were talking about the Offspring videos, is there's an archetype or like a trope of a character in this movie, and that is the white guy who is taking on the persona of a hip hop rap guy.
Yes.
And it's like, it's very cartoonish and over the top in this movie, but there's other characters. This was a thing back in those years. Like, you'll remember, like Jamie Kennedy, who was Randy in Scream, right? He had like a whole, they made a movie of him called, he had some like sketch comedy character that was this. It was like the white guy who's a hip hop guy. And I feel like there was a point in time in those early 2000s where that was like a thing, that was like a trope. And it's not anymore. And I feel like
Thank goodness.
Yeah. It's funny. It was a thing for a minute there, but it's not anymore. And I'm happy to see that one go, but there's like a very archetypal representation of that thing in this movie. If you need a cultural artifact of it. Yeah.
So cringeworthy.
Very weird. No.
Dialogue is so bad in that.
It's awful.
That's Detour. And you've seen the 2 minutes that you need to see of Detour. There you go. Now we're going to move into The Deviants, 2004, directed by Reed Waterer. Now, I want to give Tiffany huge props on this one because we could not find this anywhere. We looked. It's not on any streaming services. I had previously reached out to the director himself, and I said, hey, can we get a copy of it? He had no idea where to get a copy of it. Oh, he's like, look, there's a DVD of this that sold on eBay, 6 months ago or something like that. We scoured the internets. We couldn't find it anywhere. And I told Tiffany, do you know where to get this? And she sent her copy to us so that we could actually
We better mail that back.
Yes. So we actually have her copy.
Okay, golly.
She sent it to us, and she like overnighted it too. Like it was here.
Man.
You guys
won't let my kids play frisbee with it. I'll make sure that we
won't use it as a coaster or anything like that. So The Deviants 2004 set this one up. She plays Marina the nudist.
What's funny about this is that it is completely different from anything else we've watched. Probably this is a comedy. This is an indie comedy. This is way closer to something like Clerks than it is to something like Delta Delta Die. I mean,
what was the comedy that we watched in episode 2 with her where she was the sister of that girl who was
I don't remember the name of it. You're gonna have to look back.
But it's in the same vein as that. Yeah, kind
it's
of comedy
it's we're it's funny we're very very accustomed over the years we're very very accustomed to watching small lower budget genre fare, horror movies, sci-fi movies, even action movies. I have spent far, far less time watching lower budget, smaller scale comedies or dramas or indie, stuff like this. So it's kind of funny to think like, I just have a blind spot for, there's probably a whole world of that stuff that exists. And some of it's just like anything else. Some of it's better and some of it's worse. But I just have a blind spot for that. But here we have this intersection of you know, someone who, for whom genre work is most well known, appearing in something like this. It's this comedy about a matchmaking service, like a dating service. And you got to understand, this is way before the internet and stuff. You couldn't just get on Tinder or whatever, right? So people who have these weird identities and weird quirks and weird hangups and aspects of their personalities that make it hard for them to find matches in dating. And so they go to get help, and they call themselves the Deviants, I suppose. And each one of them, Tiffany, for example, is a nudist. There's a guy who can't do anything unless he dresses up like a luchador with a wrestling mask on. There's a guy who pretends to be in a wheelchair because that's the way that he feels most comfortable. There's a guy, I will say, the guy who really cracked me up is the pool boy who had an obsession with peeing in the pools.
Peeing in the pool.
That one cracked me up. So it's these weirdo characters. It's almost like a sketch comedy thing because it's all these little vignettes about these little different characters, and they intersect a few times throughout the thing. So you know, whether that ultimately works for you or not, I did think it was pretty funny in certain parts. The whole thing didn't necessarily add up to be something that I was super into, but there's definitely some laughs in it. And Tiffany is very game in this movie. She really earned her paycheck in this one.
And we see, like, the opening scene is her, right? And she's out there and she's got the trench coat on and she, like, flashes some college professor. It is, I found the film kind of charming.
Yeah, I would agree.
I don't think it wasn't my kind of humor. I didn't find it super funny. I liked the concept and the idea of it. They all have these weird little sexual kinks that they're just not compatible with anybody else. And this guy, what do they have it? Their tagline, Hopeless Romantics, his tagline is, "We'll find your mate, not just a date."
Hopeless Romantics, we'll find your mate, not just a date.
And so, like, this guy, that's what he, like, the main character in this, the main guy who's doing, like, his whole goal is, like, he wants to have a simultaneous orgasm with his wife or his girlfriend or whatever, and he can't get it. So he's, like, very clinical about it, scientific, like, oh, we were 23 seconds away today.
And besides, what's the big deal with the simultaneous orgasm anyway? That's just a silly romantic notion.
Madeline, a simultaneous orgasm is tangible evidence of a relationship working in perfect harmony.
Yeah, Perry Shen is in this. We'll see him next episode in The Hazing. So all Perry right. Shen, I don't know if this is the first time that Tiffany and Perry Shen kind of were in the same movie together. But Perry Shen shows up in this. Tiffany's role in this is kind of interesting because she's playing like... She's playing a nudist, but she wants her partner to just love her for who she is, and not
the joke is that it's not sexual at all. That's just how she prefers to feel comfortable.
Yeah, she just feels comfortable like this. And there's a whole sequence where there's this one dude that they set her up with, and she answers the door completely naked. And she's acting completely nonchalant about it, like, oh, this is no big deal. This is
that
just how I am.
That's pretty funny.
Busy, but I just met you.
Yeah, but I'm naked. You're naked. That's fuck.
God, you're not a nudist. You're an asshole.
He is funny. And he mentions, like, she goes in the bathroom or something, and he starts taking off all of his clothes. And she makes this, like, this little soliloquy into the mirror. She's like, people liberate themselves from the confines of clothing, tend to sexualize their bodies or something like that.
This is awesome. When they told me you were a nudist, I thought you'd be one of them roly-poly furry armpit hippies.
Yeah, I know, it's funny. A lot of people who liberate themselves from the confines of clothing tend to desexualize their body.
Because he makes some sort of crack about, well, the people that are actually nudists that I know are not kind of like smoke shows, you know, and Tiffany's very beautiful and whatnot. But she's very like, I want people to love me for me. Not, you know, she just wants to sit down and eat popcorn and watch a movie. And he's like, no, man, we got to have sex because we're naked sort of thing. So I like that they were trying to write something different and sort of playing off different sort of like a stereotypes and against each other. I liked it in that sense, but yeah, I don't think the film was necessarily for me. I didn't, it reminded me of when we walked out of Babes, honestly, because that side story is kind of funny. And
I would like to do like some kind of episode on Babes at some point. Cause
yeah. So complete side tangent for everyone. I know everyone wants to get to this mystery movie, and you're like, "Shut up!" Like, we want it. We want to get to it. We're gonna hold you for those watch hours just a little bit longer for a side tangent. Jeff, myself, Tina, your wife went, and then my friend Josh, who's a contributor to Outpost Unknown. We have these mystery movies at our theater chain here in town. There's a mystery movie called Babes. We didn't know it was. We get right there, we start watching it. How would you describe this movie?
Well, it's like it's sort of like The Deviants, only 20 years later, and much raunchier, much less less like bright-eyed and bushy-tailed, and with like an in is it, you know, whatever R-rated content is in The Deviants, and there certainly is, obviously, as we've just described. It has a sort of like innocence to it.
Yeah, and there's like sex scenes in it, but there's not tons of like tons of nudity.
It's
in
all
the sex
very
played for laughs.
Yeah,
things of that
yeah. Nature. There's it's yeah. I don't. It's a strange thing that I'm describing. But then we go and see Babes, and it's just. I guess it's like any. They're doing all of the stuff that they did in something like The Deviants, but they just make it super offensive and off-putting. And I'm just like, I'm not going to sit here and take this. It's like someone walking up and spitting in your face. I'm like, okay, well, what? And then you do it again. I'm like, okay, I'm out, you know? So yeah, that's no offense, I suppose, to anyone who liked it. It just might not have been for me, but yeah.
It was one of those things, the first movie I've ever got up and walked out of.
Yeah.
And I've seen a lot of bad movies and movies. And we looked it up afterwards. This movie's like 100%
Oh, yeah, people like it. People like it.
Yeah. People love this movie, but man,
I think it's really interesting to compare it to The Deviants, because if you just write down on paper what this one's doing and what that one's doing, it's a lot of the same type of stuff, I suppose, really. Telling the same type of joke. Using the same type of language and stuff, but the ending up completely being received completely differently by someone like me.
Yeah.
So it's kind of an interesting comparison.
Same here. So that is The Deviants. I would say if you can find a copy of this, it's worth a look. I think there's definitely something of worth to this. Did I love the movie? No, it really wasn't for me, but there's definitely funny stuff in it. The writer and the director, they're trying to do something kind of interesting with it. Like I said, way before this was like...
It seems very well intended, in my opinion. Yeah. It seems very well intended.
Yeah. And Tiffany ends up, if you guys never do end up seeing this movie because you can't find it, Tiffany actually ends up with the guy who is... He is trying to stretch his penis out to get to 13 and a half inches to break the world record or something like that. Yeah. Right.
That's the punchline. It's a good joke. Like at the beginning of the movie, he's saying, if I only had a little bit more, I would be more confident. And so he's doing all these horrible things like tying a brick to himself and hanging it so that he'll stretch himself out. And then the punchline is that, well, he was 13 and he really wanted 13 and a half. And it's pretty
the world record.
It's actually kind of funny.
Yeah, I don't know how many clips I can play of Tiffany in this for obvious reasons, but I might black bar some stuff here and there and whatnot. So those are the movies, Jeff. And now everybody who started this long episode is probably now thinking, finally, like The Rock, right? Finally, we're about ready to talk about this lost mystery movie. Now, a little bit of backstory on this. I want to caution everybody. Because I have been in communication with the filmmakers on this and whatnot. This movie is not in any sort of finished state. This is not a movie that is, you know, locked and was just put in a vault somewhere. Don't expect this movie to see the light of day anytime soon, if at all. You know, this was just sort of a thing where I kind of reached out to the filmmakers and I said, hey, I see this on the IMDb page. I'm trying to learn some information about it. We started talking and we were able to, you know, get into that temple, dodge the darts and pull out some footage of Tiffany Shepis back from 2001. Now, before I sort of describe a little bit about what this movie is, what movie are we going to talk about, Jeff?
It's called Smoke Pot Till You Effing Die.
Yes. Okay. Smoke Pot Till You Fucking Die from 2001, directed by Ben Klein and James Lynch. And again, Tiffany Shepis for all I know, has never seen any of this footage. Yeah. So, Tiffany, if you're hearing this and suddenly you're like, they're showing what? I apologize profusely. But hopefully, she doesn't cancel our show at this point in time. But we thought this would be just kind of a really cool thing to show Tiffany Shep as fans. Now, I can't get into the story of what the story is about or what the movie's about or anything like that. But what I can tell you is this was a sort of lost trauma film. So this was made by a bunch of trauma alumni. Tiffany Shepis obviously is in it. The great Julie Strain, who we were just talking about, and Delta Delta Die is in it. Of course, Lloyd Kaufman is in this. Doug Sackman is in this as well. And I do want to mention, Doug Sackman is still working for Troma to this day. He just did the special effects on Shakespeare's Shitstorm for Lloyd Kaufman. I think that was Lloyd's last big main feature movie. Mm-hmm. And I think we talked about on episode one, our kind of love for Troma and growing up with Troma. And it's so cool to me that like there's still people from Troma's heyday that are still there dedicated to putting out trauma content. And honestly, I have still not seen Shakespeare's Shitstorm. I don't even know how to get a hold of it. I don't know if it's out on DVD or Blu-ray or what. And it just makes me wonder, man, like what happens to trauma when Lloyd goes?
Yeah.
He's getting up there in years. It's like, does it keep on trucking along? I hope people like Doug Sackman and these others keep the trauma spirit alive. And Doug is producing a Sergeant Kabuki Man 2. So that's another thing, and I'll show a teaser for that right now.
Fatal Sushi, Lethal Chopsticks. Sergeant Kabuki Man, NYPD. Born out of the mind of Lloyd Kaufman, Sergeant Kabuki Man, NYPD, has netted Troma some of the greatest attention and best reviews in its 46-year history. TV, movies, a Saturday morning cartoon show, comic books and graphic novels, a run for presidency, and even his own talk show. Hey! Now, 30 years later, having defeated the villains and become the hero, allegations arise. And Kabuki is me-too'd right off the police force.
Hey, I heard about this guy running around with makeup on.
Disgraced, Harry falls deeper into depression. Harry Griswold, once a New York City cop, and the superhuman hero Kabuki Man, but no longer. After losing Lois, his mentor and the love of his life, Griswold has lost control of his Kabuki powers. In a world at the brink of destruction, between a global pandemic, race wars, and police brutality, an ancient spirit has returned to take advantage of this opportunity. Without a Kabuki defender, corruption and perversion finds a way to rise again in the resurrected form of the Evil One. Recruiting an army of villainy, the Evil One returns to his old haunting grounds to find out who has engineered his return. And now, there's only one being who can stop him. Severely alcoholic, on the run from the cops and living in the gutter, Harry must face his inner demons and his inner Kabuki spirit to regain his superpowers. Harry entices his homeless friends to train with him and to become the fighting force against the Evil One's minions. Meanwhile, a mysterious female Kabuki warrior emerges to defend the city from this new rise of villainy. Will Harry win his battle with booze and successfully restore the powers of Sergeant Kabuki Man, NYPD? Or will this new female Kabuki Man take his place? Find out in Kabuki Man Returns.
from Troma, of course.
So there you go. There's a teaser for Sergeant Kabuki Man 2. So again, a lot of Troma alums in this, and we were able to get some footage. So what you're about to see, ladies and gentlemen, exclusive for all Tiffany Shepa's fans. I'll set the stage here. We have three different scenes, I think. These are partial scenes. They're not complete scenes. This is sort of raw footage cut into sort of rough cut form, so you're not going to get the bells and whistles of sound effects and music and stuff like that. This is just sort of like a snapshot in time in 2001 as some filmmakers from Troma were putting together this movie. So yeah, sit back, get ready, and we're going to play these scenes for you right now.
Yo, I'm not going to use that toilet. It's still all full of that stuff.
Whatever, I told you this fucking complex was ghetto. Fucking minute you moved in here, it's a shithole. And I wouldn't even try talking to fucking Paco, the landlord, about this shit because he doesn't speak English, let alone no plumbing. Fucking call somebody.
Yeah, I don't know though, it's weird. It's like, it's not backed up necessarily, it's just like, it's, there's more of whatever that stuff is in there. I don't know, I'm gonna wait, I'm gonna see what happens. If it doesn't clear itself up, I'll call a plumber.
Well, I don't really give a fuck what you do, but I would do it fast. I heard about some guy one time that got a finger that was thumping around in his toilet and he had to use Drano or some shit to kill it. But it didn't work because it was just a finger and it needed to be a whole hand or some shit. And that's really fucked up. You know that we can't tell anybody about this, right? I mean, we don't need every little motherfucker on the block coming here for a free handout, you know that. I mean, this is our shit.
Wait, you know, I mean, have you ever stopped to think about why this is happening?
No.
Think about it, there's fucking marijuana growing out of my bathroom. Where's all my stuff?
Oh, it's okay, this is your stuff. I just had to get like a few slip covers and things and some curtains and things like that because, well, this place looks a little shitty. I mean, not in a bad way, but I just want to make it look good and, oh, actually, I had to take a few things out of the closet. I mean, shit that you didn't wear, you know, just so I can make room for all the other stuff, the new stuff, and now we can like entertain and have cocktail parties and be like a real couple and, oh, and there's like one other thing. I was just thinking that, well, I mean, you make a really good salary, right? You do. And it's just not going to really be enough for the two of us. And, well, since I have school and all, I can't really get a job. So I was thinking that maybe, you know, we do have all this weed. I mean, got so much fucking weed. No, dude, you're an asshole. Because I fucking came here to apologize to you. Even after you treated me like complete shit. And you're gonna fucking now ignore me? You're gonna be a dick to me?
Yeah.
You know what, dude? Fuck you! Fuck you and your little fucking bitch-ass dick. You're a fucking loser. And if it wasn't for that motherfucking pot plant in your bathroom, I would have left your bitch-ass and your miniature dick a long time ago.
There you go, folks. Never-before-seen footage from the lost Troma film, Smoke Pot Till You Fucking Die. Jeff, what are your thoughts on
this? That's cool. What a cool story to, like, you reach out to someone. Just, it's the power of the internet. Like, you know, the internet is a double-edged sword. There's all sorts of bad stuff going on, but what kind of cool stuff can happen too? And you just have an opportunity to reach out to someone and find something like this. It's super cool.
Yeah, yeah. And big, big thanks to Doug Sackman and James Lynch for sort of providing this footage and allowing us to sort of show it to the Tiffany Shepa's fandom. Like I said, don't expect this movie to show up on your store shelves anytime soon. It may never come out. I mean, it's been lost for that for 25 years almost. But it is cool that we were able to get that out there. And if you are interested, you know, if it's something like, man, I want to see that, and there's some, you know, groundswell support that to get this movie out.
Yeah, who knows?
Send us an email at outpostunknown@gmail.com. I'll make sure it gets to the right channels, to the people who need to see it. And maybe someday you will see Smoke Pot Till You Fucking Die in the craziness that was that movie. So there you go, ladies and gentlemen. I hope you stuck it out to us. We're at the hour and 17 minute mark. Uh-huh. I was adding this up. I mean, we have hours of Tiffany Shepa's content now. Oh, every episode's been over an hour long. Yep. So there's that. Now, we're wrapping up. But we have to tease what's happening next episode. Now, if you thought that tonight's episode was fantastic because we introduced you to all of these new things that you never knew Tiffany Shepis was in, well, we have another cool episode next. So we are going to have, I'm going to call it Shepevsky-a-thon. So we are going to watch all of the collaborations between director Rolf Konevsky and Tiffany Shepis. So they're really, really good friends. I actually reached out to Rolf Konevsky on our Hazing Forgotten Horrors episode that I did. I'm still waiting to get the next episode out. I've been so busy. So people who have messaged me asking when's the next episode of Forgotten Horrors coming out, it will come out as soon as I can find myself some time. I'm working on movie projects and whatnot. But I first spoke to Mr. Konevsky then. He provided all kinds of information about The Hazing, which we are going to cover next episode. And we're going to hopefully have him on for that episode as well, so he can sort of walk us through sort of his journey with Tiffany Shepis and how she, her roles in all these different films and whatnot. So we're going to be covering The Hazing, the aforementioned The Hazing, Corpses from 2004, Nightmare Man from 2006, Mood Boobs from 2006, Pretty Cool 2 from 2007, and The Black Room from 2017. So if you are interested in the Rolf Konevsky version of Tiffany Shepis's filmography, we will be covering all those, hopefully with Mr. Konevsky as well, where we can sort of chat with him and ask him about all these various films. And we did cover Emmanuel 2000, Intimate Encounters, on episode 3.
Of course.
So if you want to see the very first, if you want to watch the very first discussion we had of a Rolf Konevsky, Tiffany Shepis collaboration, Emmanuel 2000, Intimate Encounters, on episode 3. Go check that out. And that's it, ladies and gentlemen. That wraps up episode, what is this, episode 5 of Gorefest at Tiffany's. Thank you so much to all of the people out there who are commenting on the videos or sending emails or, you know, giving us a thumbs up and getting us the views. It's very, very cool. Be sure to hit that like and subscribe button because, again, we don't put these out on a set schedule. We put these out roughly once a month, but hey, we get busy, and you know that's why there's been such a gap between episode 4 and this episode. But again, thank you so much to Tiffany Shepis for providing us. Thank you, Francisco Javier, for providing us a bunch of that stuff as well. If you are a Tiffany Shepis fan and you have stuff that you want us to see, send it our way. You know, leave a comment down below or outpostunknown@gmail.com. Send it to us and we'll check it out. Jeff, any final thoughts? You want to take us out?
Yeah, I mean, this was a cool episode, a wide variety of things, even the movies that she wasn't in or functionally not in, like The Ghouls, etc. Really cool and really interesting. So it's neat when, even when you might be disappointed that our star wasn't in the movie for more than sort of a bit part, the movie itself turned out to be pretty cool. That's a pretty fortunate situation. So this was a good episode. I would recommend you check out these movies.
Yeah. And check out all of our previous episodes. Get them watch view hours up for us, man. Like, come on. All right. So with that, thank you, everybody. And we'll see you on the next episode.